At its most basic level, a blockchain is merely a highly specialized type of database. Here on the right, you can see a very generalized and broad categorization of databases. Fundamentally, we can either have centralized or distributed databases. Of course, with a centralized database, you would have to trust a single database. There's no consensus to be reached. With distributed databases, that's where the idea of trust starts to be more of a concern. In distributed databases, you could have a network of trusted fault-tolerant databases. However, within distributed databases, we can also have distributed ledgers, which generally imply looser trust guarantees. They enable parties who don't fully trust each other to come to consensus. And then finally, blockchains are a subclass of distributed ledgers. We'll go into detail in a bit. One note is that while there might be contention in what the definition of distributed and decentralized and centralized actually mean in the context of database classification, especially within the blockchain space, in this course, we generally mean in terms of politics and geography. For example, we might refer to an organization's database systems as centralized because they all operate by a single entity, so they're politically centralized. And in terms of geography and spatiality, we could have a single central database or multiple databases, either geographically centralized or decentralized. To better understand this, let's go back to the form of databases most people are familiar with, centralized databases. Centralized databases, such as a single password server, are located, stored, and maintained in one location, with one central entity handling all requests and data processing. Some advantages of this are design simplicity, immediate data updates, cost effectiveness, and minimal redundancy. However, centralized databases also have many inherent disadvantages. They are prone to bottlenecks, lack simultaneous write access by multiple users to the same dataset, and act as a single point of failure. On the other hand, distributed databases consist of groups of nodes which trust each other and cooperate to maintain a consistent view of the overall system. Because there's no longer a single point of failure, the system is more fault tolerant and can handle more demand by distributing load evenly across all nodes. However, distributed databases also introduced increased complexity, cost, and redundancy, as well as exposing more points of failure. And that's just the overhead of being distributed. A specific type of distributed database is a distributed ledger, which contain nodes operated by different entities that may or may not trust each other. While many consensus mechanisms exist for distributed ledgers, those that specifically implement a chain of blocks in their record keeping and consensus protocols are known as blockchains. Recall from our Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies course that the fundamental innovation of blockchain was not to enable distributed information sharing. As we have just seen, many forms of distributed databases exist that allow for distributed information sharing without a blockchain. Instead, blockchain's uniqueness lies in its distributed record keeping and decentralized exchange of value. Compared to a traditional database, a blockchain system is uniquely able to remove the need for centralized administrators and allow for non-trusting parties in the network to interact with each other. Blockchains can also be categorized based on their architecture and the trust and access permissions that a typical user possesses. Most generally, all blockchains fall into either public or permission categories. Public blockchains are the most widespread and well-known type of blockchains. Some examples include the two most popular cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin and Ethereum. Everyone in the world has access to public blockchains, can propose to make changes in their protocols, and can also participate in their consensus mechanisms. This makes public blockchains advantageous in providing decentralization and censorship resistance. The network effects associated with the use of public blockchain platforms result in increased application development. For example, there are thousands of dApps built on Ethereum, and often less than 100 per private platform. However, since public blockchains are open and accessible to everyone by definition, they limit the type of information that can be stored directly on the blockchain. Sensitive and private data, for example, medical records, social security numbers, and private keys, should not be put on a blockchain in plain text. Also, public blockchains inherently function in a trustless environment. Trust is no longer placed in people and organizations, but rather in the math and code behind the system as a whole. Looking away from fully trustless public blockchains, we have what are known as permission ledgers or permission blockchains. Within the category of permission blockchains, there are both fully private blockchains, where permissions are centralized to one authority, and also consortium or federated blockchains, where permissions are controlled by a central group of entities. In permission blockchains, write permissions are limited to one central entity or consortium of entities, and read permissions may or may not be limited as well. Permission blockchains allow organizations to change the rules of the blockchain at their discretion, allow for cheaper transactions, provide greater privacy, and mitigate the risk of traditional consensus-based attacks. Unlike traditional public blockchains, permission blockchains don't have the property of being publicly open and trustless. However, in an enterprise setting, permission blockchains might be used to solve a coordination problem amongst the loosely linked constituents. While blockchain is still in its infancy, many tech powerhouses have already started to show interest. For example, Microsoft recently released the Blockchain Workbench, which is a set of tools on the Azure platform for developers that work with distributed ledger technology. Workbench aims to streamline the process by which companies can build applications on top of Azure-based blockchains through setting up infrastructure so that developers can focus on the logic of the application. Hyperledger is a blockchain consortium that is led by IBM and the Linux Foundation and summons development efforts from companies across industries and sectors to build together. The goal of the project is to develop an enterprise blockchain platform that is highly modular and highly configurable for enterprise clients to customize their own blockchain solutions. Hyperledger currently focuses on tackling problems in supply chain, healthcare, and finance. Companies such as Walmart and Nestle have used Hyperledger to track food delivery in their supply chains. The Ethereum Enterprise Alliance is an organization within the Ethereum community hoping to extend Ethereum's influence on enterprise. It's a consortium of over 150 Fortune 500 companies and startups, and also institutions and governments that provide a standard framework for companies trying to build enterprise blockchains using Ethereum as the base layer. Despite enterprise movement towards blockchain, there's still differing perspectives and sentiment about blockchain technology as a whole. And this all depends on the audience you're speaking to, of course. There are those who may be Bitcoin maximalists, who believe in the original vision of Bitcoin and blockchain and despise enterprise blockchains for associating political centralization with the decentralized initial vision of blockchain. And there are also the people who say that enterprise blockchain sucks. Different people of different backgrounds tend to have this shared opinion. Bitcoin maximalists might not like the use of blockchain by the companies that was originally created to circumvent. And these same individuals might really advocate for the use of cryptocurrencies. Meanwhile, perhaps those with more experience in the traditional industry might also say that enterprise blockchain sucks, but for the reason that they understand and prefer more traditional, politically centralized cloud solutions. Industry may also have those who know to dissociate cryptocurrencies and blockchain. And some might even be too optimistic about blockchain being useful in every single enterprise use case. And also, finally, there are those who are more educated and recognize the strengths and weaknesses of the applicability of blockchain technology. Blockchain can be cool, but only in very particular ways. It's a misconception that enterprise blockchains are always useful. Some use cases have fundamental flaws, usually a misalignment with the core strengths and benefits of blockchain and distributed ledger technologies. These use cases don't warrant using a blockchain, and could perhaps be addressed with centralized or distributed databases, but not a blockchain. It's also a misconception that blockchains are more efficient than some centralized solutions. This misconception can be addressed from many different angles. The question is, how do we define efficiency? If we're talking about computational efficiency, then we already know that blockchains are highly redundant and therefore not computationally efficient. After all, why write to potentially tens of thousands of nodes all over the world when you could just write to a couple, if not just one? On the other hand, efficiency could be analyzed further, at which point it's a matter of contemplating the trade-offs between decentralization and scalability. Generally, blockchains are very costly to maintain and develop, since it's mainly a community effort. And finally, another misconception might be that if an enterprise use case has already decided on using a blockchain, they might think they should build their own blockchain rather than using existing infrastructure. Building your own blockchain isn't as simple as one might expect. In the past, many projects did just end up forking the Bitcoin blockchain's codebase, but nowadays, existing blockchain development frameworks have been proven to be successful and secure.